Richard Pryor. I think that's when I knew. It kind of clicked, you know, clicked in my head. Man, all these people are here to see him and to listen to him and just listen to him talk. You know, because I never looked at it and I still don't, you know, they say, oh, you know, it must be, you know, having a father like that, living like that. That's all I've ever known. It was like my dad was working at a factory to me because I've only known that. So it wasn't anything different for me at all.
Wow. Wow. Now let's piggyback. Your grandmom, is that Richard Pryor's mother running the brothel?
His grandmother, my great grandmother, his grandmother raised him.
Okay.
My great grandmother.
Oh, okay. Okay.
And mom was actually a prostitute as well.
Yeah, I know. Richard Pryor, your grandmother.
She was in the business as well. Her name was Gertrude.
Wow. Now, tell us about that. You were in an environment of kind of chaos, you know. If that's the right word, it wasn't anything.
Well, it wouldn't be for me. It wouldn't be chaos for me because that's all I knew.
Right.
So it was a normal way of life. Somebody from the outside might look at it and say, that's a jacked up family, or, you know. But to me, you know, there was pimp holes and prostitutes and, you know, and girls going to turn tricks while you're sitting there playing a game of spades and, you know, they hold the hand and all that was normal.
Hmm.
So it wasn't like I looked at it like a different thing. It was what it was. You know, cursing people out when you were 3 and 4 years old because you thought that's what you're supposed to do.
Wow.
But then on the other side, I would go home and everything, and I kind of have to be deprogrammed a little bit when I went back home to my mom's side of the family. So, you know, even when I went to my dad's, you know, coming back home, like get home, my mother would be like, take the garbage out, wash the dishes, you know, all those kind of things, you know, and it kept me level-headed, definitely, without a doubt.
And so I'm listening to you. I kind of get that's kind of how you learned or honed in your acting skills, so to speak.
Well, yeah, that could be it. But I think because I believe all of us actually a part of who I am. People ask me, do you think if your dad wasn't an actor or comedian that you would do it? I think I would still be doing some type of performance because it's actually inside of me. It's actually a part of who I am. You know, it's in my DNA.
Mm. Wow. And so all of that was going on, that was like a chaotic norm to you. Is that right? That was like, that was the norm. That was something that you learned to deal with.
That was my life.
Hmm.
You know, and it wasn't even anything to be ashamed of. It's what we did.
Right, right.
Yeah.
Now let's get into, you know, I did some research or whatever on you. Let's get into, I know that you were molested.
Oh, yeah, a lot. It happened to me a lot in my life.
How many times do you think you were molested?
Oh, my God.
Was it just by men or was it by men and women?
Both.
Wow.
Majority was men and women. You know, one of the women, her name was Mary Whitecloud. I'll never forget. She was working as a small extra on one of my dad's films he did with Fred Williamson called Adios Amigos. And I remember that. And the reason why I remember that was because it was like, you know, she was going over my dad and instructed her to do this. You know, it was like he was, you know, showing me a way of life and introduced me to, you know, a woman and all that stuff. And I think he was doing what he was, the way he was taught and the way he was raised and what he went through, because my dad went through molestation as well. You know, So, you know, quite a few, you know, people in my life, you know, friends of the family, relatives, all that stuff throughout my life has always been there.
Yeah.
It happened even when I was younger.
Yeah.
Elana, it's okay. It's an interview.
Yeah, I see that. That's a personal question. But I spoke to Richard, you know, before we, you know, discussed to do this, that he was okay with discussing and talking about all of this. So don't come at me, guys.
She's like my protector. She's my little sister, but she loves me so much, you know. And
I know.
She's had instances where I've been interviewed before and she was in on the things and people were just like attacking me.
Yeah.
And she was trying to be there for me, and people were just relentless with her and just hurting her so much, you know. Yeah. So she doesn't understand this side of the things.
Yeah,
the public side. She just sees her big brother, who right. she loves a lot.
Right. I mean, that's just how I operate anyway. I always ask, you know, the person that I'm interviewing, you know, is there anything off the table or off limits that you do not want to discuss? And, you know, I feel like, you know, you want to be respectful, but I mean, a lot of this stuff is in your book anyway.
Yeah. So. And then there's things that, you know, I may not want to talk about. If I don't want to talk about it, you know, you would know, you know, when I'm being interviewed, they'll know. 'Cause I'll say, I don't feel like, you know, using names or anything right now, but you know, I went through a lot of stuff in my life. So,
Yeah. And I'm glad that you are here and being transparent, because I don't want just this to be an interview and talking about your dad and all that type of stuff. I want people to walk away being helped. So I want you to help someone out there that may be going through molestation and going through being around certain environments or whatever. And I want you to be able to speak to them and to let them know that just because where they are now, and it may be a dark place, it may be chaotic, it does not mean that you're going to stay there, and that the Lord is not going to, you know, bless you, or not going to establish you and put you into a better situation to prosper you. And that's according to his word anyway, that he wants to prosper us and, you know, give us, you know, the desires of our heart. So I want you to help somebody, man.
Yeah, you have to, you know, because when I first started this book, first started on the journey of writing, wanting to do a book, when I first started out, it was about being a son of.
Yeah.
You know, because I was like, you know, that's what people want to know about, being a son of somebody. By the time I was finishing the book, it was about, man, how can I help somebody who's in some darkness, in the same darkness I've been in? How can I let somebody know they don't have to stay like that, and they don't have to allow their circumstances and the things they've been through in life, allow those things to dictate now who they are? How can they take those things that they've been through and they've gone through, how can they take those exact same things and make it a strength and not a weakness?
Hmm.
And I think that's where things started changing, even in my life and my way of thinking on everything, because a lot of times we're in something or we did something and we're a part of something, we think we're there and that's where we're going to be.
Mm-hmm.
And never seeing any way of coming out of something. It's like being in something when you're like, why is this always happening to me? But then when you think back and look back on it, everything that you dictated and everything that you said and everything that you mentioned, everything that came out of your mouth was a part of that negativity. So if all that's a part of your negativity, how do you think anything positive is going to be there? You know, you have to change the people you've been around, the people you talk to, the things that you allow to get into your ear and into your head. Those things you have to change.
Mm-hmm.
You know, the things you read, the things you watch, all those things have to change within your life in order to see a change.
What helped you, Richard, going through, you know, being molested and, you know, just seeing so much, being around so much at a young age that your normal kid won't ever see or experience? What helped you? What helped you, you know, not lose your mind, not be the victim?
I did lose my mind. There was times I did.
Well, what helped you? What helped you get it back?
I think what it really, really, really turned out to be is something I said I would never do, and that was to go to church again and be a part of Body of Christ again.
Wow.
I think that's, you know, just one for me, because I'd been.